And welcome to Sunday at the Manor live with Dr. JJ. As we prepare to gather, we will acknowledge the territory. As they gather for worship, we honor and thank the Huron-Wendat Nation, the Métis Nation of Ontario, Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation, Mississaugas of Stugag Island First Nation, and Six Nations of the Grand River as our community partners and traditional inhabitants of the lands of the City of Toronto, the region of Hamilton, Durham region, and surrounding areas. May we stand in the river of time to bring the water of healing and connect it to the heartbeat of the ancestors as one.
Reverend JJ, you're mute.
We'll try that again. Special welcome to those who are here in person, also those who are online, and it's happy belated Canada Day to many. And it's wonderful now in Canada, we sort of straddle the first, the second, the third, we sort of take advantage of our American brothers and sisters and sort of keep going with our fireworks, which I think is a wonderful way to celebrate and begin. Let us continue on. So remember, we continue with yoga at the Manor, and then I'll close next Sunday. And then you notice that the lawn is growing, which is good news. And we overcame our flooding moment. This is celebrating our wonderful graduates for 2022. Yes. Ruben on the left, and James McKinnon, the rock star on the right. And there we go. And that was a great moment. And I love the leap. That's good. That's what I felt like when I graduated grade 13. We don't have grade 13 anymore, but we should have grade 13 because so many people do victory laps. There we go. Well, wisdom and opinion. So here's a note. Manuel found this in our wonderful pantry. Basically, it reads, to the food donors, thank you. My family has benefited greatly from your generosity. So remember, bring in your tins and your packages to continue the spirit of benevolence and caring for each other with our outdoor pantry of the man. And maybe we'll plunge forward as with our call to worship. Call upon the Lord. I asked for help and I was healed.
We asked for freedom and we were given liberty beyond measure. Praise God.
Jesus, you have come to the lake shore. Look
And Betty, we didn't mean to leap over you. Did you have anything to report for perinatal care? Yes, good. I think you must send out psychic vibrations to say yes, yes. It's a long hook.
Good morning, everyone, and what a beautiful day. We do continue our prayers for members of our congregation on outreaching. Mike has given thanks for Kathy, who came through her surgery and is now continuing with a conservative approach, which is great, and that was good news. But you mentioned your friend Derek in BC, who is now facing his cancer journey, and we keep him in his prayers, and Kathy too, still, we will do that. We continue with Norma G, Stephen, Susan Shaw Russell's brother on our list, and all those others on our prayer list. We send condolences to a friend, an attendee of Manor, Ron McIntosh, who received news from his nephew Derek that his brother Bobby had died this week. So we will keep the McIntosh family in our prayers and thoughts. For the world, listening to news this week, realizing how impacted the children of the world are by famine and war. And we will keep those children in our hearts and minds. The morning quote by Newell was very good, which talked about us revering our Mother Earth and bringing our Earth back. May we pray that the Ukrainian and Russian lands will be brought back to Mother Earth from war. I don't have my birthday list. I haven't unpacked it yet. So I will simply wish a happy birthday to anybody with a birthday in July. And eventually I will find it. And that's it for this week.
If you're born in July, happy birthday. And you have looked like you want to say something.
I just heard this news about 5 minutes ago. So I didn't have time to ask Betty to pray for the Roth family as Sarah. My friend Joe, I think some of you have met before, he's ready to greet his new grandchild. Wow. Sarah is in labor this morning, so everybody just keep Sarah in your thoughts. She knows she's having a little boy, and his name is Nolan. So we hope that everything goes well with the labor and delivery, and I'm really excited to meet this new child.
Wonderful.
His name is Nolan.
Nolan Robb.
Okay. R-O-B-B, right?
R-O-B-B.
All right. Okay. Let me say, God be with you.
And also with you.
Oh God, you send us out to the world as your disciples.
Allow the church to be a healing presence, a place and a people that live out the essence of your kingdom. Here and now, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen.
Time to light. Lighting is very important. Okay. And we say, let there be light. And may the angels of light listen for us this day. And may the spark of God's beauty dance in the eyes of those we love. And may the universe be on fire with a presence for us this day.
May the new sun's rising grace us with gratitude. Let earth's greenness shine and its waters breathe the spirit. Let heaven's winds stir the soil of our souls. And fresh awakenings rise within us. Amen.
And God, you have caught us in our sinful behavior.
We come to you with the hope of your restoration.
We walk with our heads held high, without noticing others and their burdens.
We are even minded to our own.
We keep our mouths silent when we're full of stories, to share about the good things that you have done for us.
We even keep our actions silent as we become so overwhelmed with the needs of the world that we do nothing to overcome them.
Fill us with your peace and with your mercy, and free us from the destruction of sin, and restore us to a life lived in you.
Amen.
Peace.
Peace is what you receive from God when you know that your sins are forgiven.
Peace is what you have when you know the destruction of sin cannot harm you. Because you are not alone in your journey of life.
Therefore, peace, my brothers, sisters, and brothers.
In Jesus, we have received forgiveness and we have been restored.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
And the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Amen. Peace of Christ. Allison, you want to join me up to have a lovely conversation? There's something about, again, this time of year, as I hear stories about children going to camp. I had a call from my good friend Dana, who's the director of Camp Snugog, which is the United Church camp, where it's fully subsidized for marginalized children. We have 10 spaces for children 12 to 15, so I phoned everyone who has a connection, about four of them, and they found fill the space, which is wonderful.
That's great.
Regent Park, St. Luke's United, Mark Goring, who's Church in the City, and the list went on. That's quite remarkable. So can we slide the next slide? Aww. Have you ever wanted to kiss a deer?
No, not exactly.
I think I kissed a goat, maybe, when I was a child. But so imagine having no fear of a deer.
Yeah.
So that's really remarkable. I think I fed a deer. But have you ever fed a deer?
Yes, I have fed a deer. Oh, yeah. Deer.
How many people have fed a deer? Put your hand up. No deer, no does and deer. Okay, let's slide to the next one. And on this weekend, when we think of all the wonderful the Canada Day weekend, and what's your favorite part of Canada?
My favorite part of Canada. Well, it's an amazing place, deeply, deeply flawed. It's such a beautiful country, and I'm really, really grateful to have been born here and live here as an adult. I don't know, maybe that we have health care. That's pretty amazing. How about you, John Joseph?
Well, I was thinking geographically, but
that's
not for me. Cape Breton. Yeah.
Oh, so nice.
I've been there many times, and it's wonderful. It's that part of Canada that was part of New France, and first, is it Mi'kmaq? If I say that correct, the Mi'kmaq people beforehand. Yeah. And then many other people. And in a very tight area, you literally have mountains and lakes and flatland.
In
the ocean, too. What about you for places?
Well, I mean, we're about to fly out to Powell River, which is the small town in BC that Tom grew up in, well, small city, I should say. And it's a pretty special place, too, like a unique place, also right on the ocean. And they have, of course, Salish people there, and they're like deeply entwined with the town, and they interact as two nations within the area. So it's a pretty special place.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, there's stuff, BC, the trees that are as wide as our sanctuary, it's quite remarkable. Yes. And you have a prayer for us today.
So for Canada Day, I was trying to compose some kind of prayer acknowledging the First Peoples of Canada, and I kept going over and over and over again. No, I'm just going to find words that come from Indigenous peoples of Canada. And I found this beautiful prayer on the United Church of Canada website from Bill Snow, who's from the Stoney Nakoda First Nation in Alberta. God, creator and great mystery, we praise you for the sacred fire that burns today, and for the prayer-filled smoke that you receive and bless.
We offer our deep gratitude that the fire's light informs and guides our journey. We pray just as the elders prayed, for renewal and for the restoration of beauty to this land and its people. We acknowledge the diverse and abundant gifts of Canada's Indigenous peoples. We recognize that their knowledge and wisdom have benefited generations past and present, and that this blessing will continue for generations to come. We remember the many who are committed to the healing of family, community, and nations. We pray for Mother Earth, the waters, the winds, for our siblings, the animals, birds, and fish, and all of life that surrounds us. We pray that we will walk the good red road of life, and that we will walk with courage, honesty, humility, love, respect, truth, and wisdom. We offer this prayer in humility and hope, and in the name of our brother Jesus, the one who lights our path to wholeness, justice, and peace. Amen.
Thank you, Allison. Your word, O Lord, is our inspiration, our light, and our motion.
Your word, O Lord, is power, wisdom, and comfort.
Guide us today as we listen to the word, read and proclaimed, and fill us with the understanding and with desire to change.
Speak, Lord, your people listen. Amen. Our first reading is from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 to 14. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man and in high favor with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man, though, a mighty warrior, suffered from leprosy. Now the Arameans, on one of the raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she said to Naaman's wife, she said to her mistress, "If only my lord were with the prophet who was in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman went in and told his lord just what the girl from the land of Israel had said. And the king of Aram said, "Go then, and I will send a long letter to the king of Israel." He went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of garments. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, "When this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you my servant Naaman, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Just look and see how he has tried to pick a quarrel with me." But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go, wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." Naaman became angry and went away, saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand on it all in the name of the Lord his God, and wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. For not of Anna and Farfar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached and said to him, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more when all he said to you was, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the fresh flesh of a young boy, and he was clean.
Second reading is from Galatians 6, verses 1 to 16. My friends, if anyone is detected in transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work, then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision or uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. For all those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy and upon the Israel of God.
Our gospel reading for today is from Luke chapter 10, verses 1 to 11 and 16 to 20. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.' And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person, but if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to you, listens to me, and whoever rejects you, rejects me, and whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me.' The 70 returned with joy, saying, 'Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us.' He said to them, 'I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Hear the wisdom told to us through the ages. Thanks be to God."
There is something about this time of year, is there not? It's a gift to have the great outdoors, to see the wonder of all of creation resounding around you. And I would say, when you make it to a lake, we're called to the outside. There's river valleys in Toronto. There's the Toronto Island. There's so much just within our own backyard. Let us pray. God, we look to you. You invite us to walk again and listen to the sound of the song of trees, of birds, of knowing that we have kindred spirit with all of creation just outside our door, minutes from river valleys, rushing water, something abounding, the untamed wilderness in the heart of our own city, the gift of God today. Amen. There's something about time, and if you think of these next, call them 8 weeks, and maybe 8 or 9 weeks, depending. Sometimes months have 5 weeks, sometimes they have four, but July and August, they're gift. I sometimes try to sort of have fun with, well, didn't the warm weather really start in March, but it got cold again? And then it lasts, let's see, sometimes till October. So that's my imagination playing tricks with myself, saying, well, we really have 6 months of warmer weather, meaning it's not minus 30. So that's sort of the good news of it all. Is it? But then when we imagine this July and August, again, whether we go away or whether we stay in city, there is so much. And it is a gift. So often we'll catch ourselves like, oh, it's 30, oh my gosh. And I always ask people, well, would you rather have minus 30 or plus 30? Let me do a little poll. Put your hand up if you like minus 30 better than plus 30. There's a few. Put your hand up if you like plus 30. There you go. See, there's a lot of range of effect. But then if we go to the Caribbean, plus 30 is really good, isn't it? Very, very, very fun. But there's something about time, is it not? That we are that time. Every moment, every second is a gift. But it's as if it encroaches upon us when we pay too much attention to the clock or the time and the rushing weeks. But savor each footstep, each breath, and each moment, to watch them grow around us and surround us with something so remarkable and so new and so special in this moment of time. But yet we hear in this passage, an interesting passage, Naaman the commander is stricken with leprosy. Now, for the most part, other than other parts, very minor few parts of the world, leprosy does not exist so much. But yet when we hear stories about it, it was a disease that would cause sometimes fingers to fall off and would mean death, and people were in leper colonies, so to speak. But then we hear Naaman the commander, great general, go wash in the Jordan 7 times. Now we hear that number 7 again and again. It was one of those sacred numbers that we, 7 days of creation, 7 times 70. And initially Naaman says, well, aren't there really wonderful rivers in our own country? Yes, but why don't you just go and do? How often have we perhaps been told, well, we just need to take this, maybe medication or something, and we maybe don't do that right away, and we wonder why we have issues or challenges and basic things, and the old remedy that perhaps our mothers taught us of having ginger ale when our stomachs are upset, and I swear by that, and so often I'll tell people, have you tried some ginger ale a day or two later? No, I didn't do that. Well, try it and see if it makes a difference. You see, cures aren't about some far distance. So often, cures and healing is in the palm of our hand, or sometimes in our fridge, right beside us. Last week, I got to have the wonderful moment, it's not so wonderful, of having a colonoscopy. All is clear, yes, but we don't talk about that so much, do we, in our society, but yet we know we need them. I remember when you reach a certain age, you're supposed to have a medical, full medical every 5 years, whether things are working properly or not. And I went to the doctor and he said, when's the last time you had one of those? And I said, well, I think it was 2016, well, you're due. And it was interesting. It was supposed to happen the week before. And I said, well, I'm too busy. I can't go yet. And then you try to look at the next week. Well, I'm too busy that week. And well, you need to do this. You need to do this. And then I asked the question, so is there going to be a local or a general? oh, well, it's going to be a local. Well, no, it wasn't. It was a general. It was a ride, and the next thing you know, they're counting back in time. I wake up 2 hours later, and there's something about the preparation, is there not? I said, I'm going to make this work for me. I bought four kinds of broth. Beef broth, chicken broth, veggie broth. I even brought Vietnamese broth, just so I could have something other than apple juice. And it worked. It was not bad, but there's something about it. When you can't have food for 2 days, Jell-O tastes like a feast. I don't know about you. I made orange Jell-O and it was really good. But the cure, the healing, the path is right in front of us. I remember learning that there's apparently some form of remedy. You can smoke basil and it helps with some form of cold. And next thing you know, if we put that in the sun, smoke basil from Manor in our church, the basil field will be clean. But yet we know this, but we've lost touch with that, haven't we? But go and wash 7 times in the Jordan. Go and do this. And be part of that creation of all peoples from the beginning of time. And the flesh was restored. His flesh was restored. Our lives are restored in that healing moment of time, and that gift of God breaking into this very day. And we hear about the restoration, as Mike read, about gentleness of spirit, remembering to be kind to each other and be living compassion. When we read that letter from the person who wrote it in the pantry, we're reminded of why do we do that? Why do we offer food? Why do we offer compassion? Not because we expect gratitude back, but because we know there are people there who stand at the edge of their tether and need a helping hand in the here and now. Just as we know in our own nation, there's many people in the here and now who need a helping hand. Camp Sugog, a wonderful program of the United Church of Canada that provides programs for children, young adults, and parents, single moms, to make a difference for people who are living below the income level. But yet in that moment of time, Sugog, Camp Sugog, fully subsidized, provides a moment of hope and healing for youth and single parents in the GTA, in the here and now today. It is a gift. But yet we know further as we read today in the gospel, Jesus sends out the 70 to do and be and make a difference. And we're caught up in that, are we not? It's about that living lives lived in the here and now. About the words, the harvest is plenty, the laborers are few. We've heard that before. What does that mean? It means each of us has a left and right foot, a left and right hand to do and be and to make a difference in the here and now. When I phoned initially to different people in the city of Toronto, there was Joanne Mastrotucci at St. Luke's, who knows people in the neighborhood. I phoned Regent Park United and let them know that there's spaces for people at Camp Sugog. You see, there are so many helping agencies. Just a matter of knowing who the people are and how today, in this moment of time, we can make a difference in the here and now, in the days ahead. Yet we know as we hear about the people going out, the harvest is plenty, the laborers are few. It's about each and every one of us bearing the burdens of each other. Bearing those burdens to be that transition in time, to be that part of our living identity. It's as if when we watch something being carried, and it was the other day, we were carrying something in to my house, and I knew I needed someone else at the other end to help bring it into the house, to know that I couldn't do this on my own. I remember years ago, someone gave me a piano. They said, well, I was conducting a wedding for that. Was there, I think, a second or third marriage? I can't remember, but I was on Highway 9. They said, well, how about we give you our piano? And I thought, wow, this is wonderful. I was living in a house, a 4-bedroom manse all by myself. There was no one to tell me that I couldn't bring it in. So guess what? That's what I did. But you'll love this part. 8 of us lifted the piano The upright grand. How many have lifted an upright grand and lived to tell about it? Not very many. The entire band was lifted this up on the back of a pickup truck. Now, fortunately, it was a heavy-duty pickup truck because, you know, there's some pickup trucks you would do that to, and the pickup truck would be meeting the ground very quickly. But you love the next part. There I was. We strapped it to the pickup truck. I'm standing beside the piano. We drive out of the driveway. We're on Highway 9. I'm not sure what I thought we were going to do or I was going to do if that piano started tipping. I think I perhaps imagined for a moment I was the man from steel from the planet Krypton or the Incredible Hulk after the gamma rays came. Because if that piano decided to start tipping, I would have kept going. Nothing wrong, but something, but by the grace of God, it didn't tip over and it stood upright. And we made it into the little community of Monument Mills and we brought it into the house, into the living room, 8 of us. And I saved $500 on piano movers. I don't recommend you do that. I recommend you hire piano movers because what I did was probably quite not the brightest thing in the world, but we did it nonetheless and we got the piano in. But it reminded me. So often, we can't carry the load by ourselves. And it's so much about letting go to realize that only when we bear each other's burden together, we bring a forward momentum and we make a difference in the here and now. Because we are the time. That moment of flesh being restored, restoring that spirit of gentleness, of washing in the Jordan River. Of in the here and now, knowing that the kingdom of God comes near. It's so often like Naaman who's ready to stand up and fight because that's all he knows. Why would we do this? Why did he do this? The time is to do this. To go wash in the Jordan, to overcome our disconnection, to know that this is the time to immerse ourselves in the season of summer, to become self-lit again, to restore, renew, and discover. I've made plans already to go to the exhibition because I like the exhibition. Some people can't stand the exhibition, but there's something about the cotton candy, all the bad food that's actually quite fun, the Mars bars that are deep fried, and it's the carnival really, isn't it? But it's that part of summer where all of us can discover again the wonder of this city that we do live in, that we're part of, in the here and the now. Last Sunday, it was pride, real pride in real time. And there was a couple of us were persevered. It's called hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait, and hurry up and wait. And if the parade is going to start at 2, well, maybe it starts 3 or 4 hours later. But there was something about being with the United Church and other colleagues, carrying this, there was a big flag in front of us. Now the Presbyterians, they were smart. They waited in the shade on the north side of Bloor. And the Anglicans, well, they were bright too. They waited in the shade in St. Paul's. United Church, we stood there in the hot sun, waiting and hurrying up. But I thought, well, guess what, kids? We were first at this table. Not to brag, but a little bit for you. But we're part of it together. And the Jewish group was there, and MCC Toronto was there, and the many standing to make a difference and be transformed. And we handed out 900 hearts that said, Happy Pride Toronto, made by our lovely Miss May. And there was a great wonder and joy. This year, unlike other years, there was more young people on the edges. There was a greater cultural diversity than I've ever seen before. And people were just so happy to be and remember. Because you have to remember, in the sidelines, in the background, in the U.S., Roe versus Wade has been overturned. In Oslo, there was shooting. We have to remember that only when we stand together to make a difference in the here and now, that we stand in solidarity, knowing that we are not alone today. Just like we hear that Naaman, his flesh was restored in that moment of time. Just like we hear that Jesus said, if they listen to you, they listen to me. It's not about shouting at each other. It's about being patient with each other to know that we are the time today. We have that gift of washing in the Jordan River. We have that gift of knowing that God is with us, to be renewed and be restored, to be the 70 in the here and now, to walk and go together in that gift of life. To look at the sky and know that there's something about it that's touching our very hearts and hearing now, that we are that time. We are that moment of knowing and renewing and restoring. We are the time to be with God, to be with Christ, to be with each other, to shout in that moment of reverie, to learn again that we wash in Jordan. Jordan is a faraway place, but the rivers that are here in the here and now. We're learning so much about our own nation. Recently, this past week, there was news that our archaeologists have discovered that people came to this to North and South America 130,000 years ago. And in Peru, they found this ancient city site that goes back 6,000 years, as old as the pyramids and as sophisticated as the Aztecs and the Mayas and the Incas. So often, we think what is here and now is all that ever has been. But remember, we not so much stand on the shoulders, we have the roots of those who come before us, living and breathing through each and every one of us. The time is now to immerse ourselves in this season of summer, to wash in that Jordan River again, to know that we are the time and together, because we are fed with the whispers and wisdom of our great-grandmothers and great-grandfathers. And that's just one of the passages I always find when we think of time. Ecclesiastes. For everything there's a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to tear down, a time to build, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak. Years ago, I heard these words, "Dost thou love life, then do not squander time, for that's the stuff that life is made of." We are the time, the gift to each other, to walk together in the here and now. To remember that we're only a phone call or a text message away, to stand strong, to be bold together.
Of the great diversity you have created, Creator, we come to you with both the joys and the sorrows of our hearts. We are grateful for the gift of life and the joy that it can bring, for families and friends who love us, for allies who stick up for us even when we cannot risk sticking up for ourselves, for the great diversity you have created in our world. We pray for those who suffer from discrimination because of the gender identity, or sexual orientation, or their skin color, who worry about their employment, or who cannot find a job, for those who must hide who they are to find housing, for those who are not safe on our streets, for those who do not feel safe in a place of worship. Help us to end homophobia, transphobia, and biphobia, and all forms of discrimination and hate. Show us the way to make this world a better place for all.
And communion is a holy sacrament for followers of Christ. In the United Church, we practice an open table, and all are welcome to partake in communion, and there is no requirement of baptism or membership. Just remind those at home to have a cookie or
piece of bread nearby, and those from the congregation also to have little cups we have distributed. We say, God is with us. We are not alone. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give thanks to you. O Lord our God, how great are your works. You created the world and all that is in it. You give the nations their names. We rebelled against your sovereign love, seeking to storm the gates of heaven, trying to make a name for ourselves in the world. But by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, you've given us your own name and have made us your own people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Now send forth your life-giving spirit to renew and recreate us. Save us, Lord. We call upon your name. Lord God, we have seen your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. We give you thanks that you have made us one with him, as he is one with you and the Holy Spirit. And by the gift of your Spirit, you have promised to fulfill the prayers that we ask in Jesus' name. And by the grace of your Spirit, we have promised to live in Christ's love and keep his commandments with thanksgiving. Remember how Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it. And gave thanks to his disciples and said, this is my body given for you. With thanks, we remember how Jesus took the cup saying, this is the cup of the new covenant, make my blood for you and for many. Remembering when Jesus ascended into heaven, he sent the Holy Spirit to teach us, to guide us and abide in us, remembering your mighty acts of mercy. We celebrate this feast with the risen Lord, offering our lives in thanksgiving and praise. Great is the mystery of faith. Fill this place with your Holy Spirit, like the rush of a mighty wind, like a consuming fire, and by the power of your Spirit, feed us with the bread from heaven, and fill us with the new wine of your reign, and make us your sons and daughters, faithful and fearless and free. Teach us to proclaim the good news of salvation to all the nations of the world, and fill us with dreams and visions of that great and glorious day, when the Lord Jesus Christ will come again, and we will eat and drink with him in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
the body of Christ, the bread of life, the lifeblood of Christ,
the cup of blessings,
the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God for the body of Christ. Grace and peace for the cup of blessing. Let us pray. For food and bread we have shared, we give you thanks. For a cup that you have offered to end thirst for all the world, we say praise be to God. May we be the food, may we be the cup, may we be the hope and the healing to mend the world today. Amen. And we take this time now to offer our life and work. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Your church exalts you. In your mercy, you have given us life everlasting. You have given us freedom from death. And you have favored us. And in your love, you have given us the strength to stand up and continue on our journey. In your wisdom, you have taken a chance on us, and by allowing us to be part of your holy plans and your message, help us to use these gifts you have given us with mercy, love, and wisdom, so that we can continue to honor the trust you have put on us. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear.
Our righteousness will go before us, and the glory of God will be under God.
God of prophets and of disciples, we've heard the plea of your people throughout the ages. Hear us now as we present to you those things that burden us. Lord of mercy,
lift us out of the mess.
Hear us as we pray for those who are sick and give them hope that they may feel through your presence and the presence of others, comfort and support. Grant them patience that they may live in your time and in your will. We believe in the power of your healing. Do your will, God. Do your will. Lord of mercy,
lift us out of the depths.
Hear us as we pray for those who live in constant conflict. Bring your wisdom to their lives. Enable your people to learn from you. whose anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Allow our anger to last only a moment, that we might put our efforts toward reconciliation and peace. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear.
Our righteousness will go before us, and the glory of God will be our God.
Lord of mercy,
hear
us as we pray for those who feel imprisoned by temptation and sin, and lead us to examine ourselves and our lives to see how and why we fall into temptation, and give us empathy to understand others in their prisons. Grant us the strength to do good, not to be weary, and to always be watchful for opportunities to do your will. Lord of mercy. Holy God, we pray for your church. Give us courage to be true disciples. The world outside these walls can be challenging, and yet others watch us as we witness and we act. Give us wisdom to better reflect your actions of love and mercy, so that our families, our communities, and our countries might understand what your kingdom is all about. As a mother nurtures her children, let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Today, be the gift to each other as we mark milestones of holidays, as we turn to discover the wonder of the world outside, to be channels of peace, to be disciples of the word. Be the gift of listening in the name of God, Christ and Spirit. Amen.
Our hands are ready now.
Nila Ole. Thank you, everybody. Thank you all for being here. We're going to turn off the recording. That's great. And I just remember to wave hello.